Guys, first of all, thank you so much for coming on the show. Welcome to London. I say welcome to London. I'm sure you've been to London before. I'm sure you've filmed here. I'm sure you've worked here. Looking forward to the premiere tonight.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, I hope you enjoy it.
Yeah. Well, I think the big memory for me is walking out the film a couple of days ago and just thinking, guys, you could have made it a lot easier on yourselves. You could have just done, you know, the same old catchphrases. You could have seen the same film, basically. But it's a continuation. It's a reimagining. Yeah. You guys worked hard on this one, it seems.
Yeah, we wanted to avoid that thing with the first sequel. You know, the sequel is just a rehash of the first movie. Mm. That was kind of our number one thing when we started, was like, let's not do that.
Yeah, no annoying glances to camera. So.
However, you are correct. We did make it very difficult on ourselves. We certainly could have been a little less ambitious. There's no doubt about it, but at some point, you got to get an animatronic shark in your movie.
That's it. Is that your first animatronic shark in one of your movies?
You've had a few in yours.
Yeah, I cut a scene out of This Is 40 where Rudd got killed by an animatronic shark.
Yeah, okay. It's a great scene. First one for me, though. I've had animatronic bears.
Right.
I've had live cougars, but as the first animatronic shark. Yeah, it was nice. It was really nice.
Is there an animatronic wrangler? People who look after these animatronic animals?
Yeah.
It's a team of scientists.
Yeah.
Because if you have if you have a robot shark, it still could bite you and kill you.
Just quicker. Yeah. They said about 5 years ago they had one that got loose, went off the cable, and something had happened with the computer in its head, and it got really smart.
Like a rogue drone.
Yeah.
It was like a Michael Crichton movie.
Yeah. It was.
It went after a Russian sub.
It did.
And then an animatronic shark from the future comes back to save humanity, I guess.
That's what happened.
And I guess, again, it's not just, you're not just filming a script with the Anchorman films and other films that you guys have done. You're working with a lot of actors who like to do a little bit of improv. How do you know when to sort of pull them back and kind of say, right, scene, this is finished, this is canon, this is done?
Well, it's actually the opposite. I think we want them to, do more improv. Mm. If anything, sometimes these are long days. The actors are like, can we just do the script sometimes?
So,
and our job is to make sure that they are pushing, that they are improvising. And sometimes, you know, we'll take the first bullet and throw out the first idea and to kind of get them going. But
but it is the most fun thing to watch. One day on the set, they were shooting the scene in the Winnebago where they're reminiscing. Mm. And Steve Carell just, I don't know how it happened, if you told him to do it or he just started doing it, but he started laughing, then laughing so hard he couldn't stop. Then he's still laughing and he starts crying because he's so scared that he can't stop laughing. And then slowly he pulls out of it and becomes a happy laughing. Laugher.
Yeah.
I mean, it was one of the funniest things I've ever seen in person.
When they catch it, it is incredible to watch. When you get that sense of, oh, they're just going right now.
Yeah.
That is the best possible thing that can happen.
Yeah. Do you have a sort of relationship with these actors where you can sort of, you almost have a inbuilt sort of bullshit detector where you sort of go, that wasn't as good as it could be. Can you sort of tell them that, you know, although the actors might be enthused with a certain thing that they've done, do you have a sort of relationship to sort of say, look, that wasn't as good as it could be. I don't think it's going to end up in the final thing.
The whole key to the environment for improv is you're never saying no. You're never saying that's wrong or not good, because the nature of improv is you're just trying it and you know that it's film, so it's only going to be one take that you're going to use.
Yeah.
So what you're trying to do is kind of push them in directions and guide rather than saying no. If it became an environment where you're going, that wasn't good or that didn't work, you couldn't improvise because everyone gets too tight at that point. So it's just got to be an environment where we can all try stupid jokes, we can try different things, and so I think our job is to also be a part of that and occasionally throw out a bad idea, occasionally throw out a good idea. Like, you just kind of never know until you really jump in.
Finally, for now, the DVD sounds like that's going to be more of an editing job than the actual film itself. You've got a lot of stuff.
I have four more scenes I got to look at, actually. I was going to watch them during lunch.
Have you almost got an extra movie to kind of, you know, delete scenes?
We do.
Different threads.
We do. We have a whole different version with all new jokes in it. Yeah, we replaced every single joke in the movie with a new joke.
Can you skip back and forth like in the middle of a joke? So you get a punchline to the other joke.
We don't have that technology
yet. That's advanced. Yeah.
Choose your own adventure. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. Enjoy the premiere and have a great year.
All right.
Pleasure. Good to see you.
Thanks.